Chapter 1 of Finn the Wolfhound. Finn the Wolfhound by Alec John Dawson. Chapter 1 The Mother of Heroes. For a man whose 30th year was still not far behind him, the man's face was over careworn. It suggested that he felt life's difficulties more keenly than a man should at that age. But it may have been that this was a necessary part of the keenness with which the whole of life appealed to him, its good things as well as its worries. He rose from his writing-table and straightened his back with a long sigh, clenching both hands tightly and stretching both arms over his shoulders as he moved across the little room to its window. The window gave him an extensive view of dully gleaming roofs and chimney-pots, seen through driving sleet towards the end of a raw forenoon in February. The roofs he saw were those of one of London's cheap suburbs, first a block of mansions similar to those in which his own flat was situated, then a rather superior block where the rents were much cheaper because they were called dwellings, and beyond that the huddled small houses of a quarter with which no builder had interfered since early Victorian days. The man turned away from the dripping window and looked round this den in which he worked. Its walls were mostly covered by bookshelves, but in the gaps between the shelves there were pictures, a rather odd mixture of pictures, of men and women and dogs. The men and women were mostly people who had written books, and the dogs were without exception Irish wolfhounds, those fine animals which combine in themselves the fleetness of the greyhound, the strength of the boarhound, and the picturesque wiry shagginess of the deerhound, those animals whose history goes back to the beginning of the Christian era, through all the storied ages in which they were the friends and companions of kings and princes, great chieftains and mighty hunters. For several minutes the man paused before a picture, underneath which was written, "The Mistress of the Kennels." This picture showed a girl with wind-blown hair, happy face, and laughing eyes, standing with a small puppy in her arms in the midst of a wide kennel enclosure on the sloping rise of an upland meadow. In the background one saw a comfortable-looking house, half hidden by two huge walnut trees and flanked by a row of aged elms. When the man had looked his fill at this picture, and at other pictures of various Irish wolfhounds, each marked with the name and age of the hound depicted, he sighed and went to the window again. While he stood there, looking out through the February sleet, the door of the den opened, and the mistress of the kennels came in, wearing a big, loose overall, or pinafore, which covered her dress completely. Her face had not quite the color which the picture made one feel it must have had when she stood in that wide, windy kennel enclosure, but it was still a sunny face. The eyes were still laughing eyes, a loving, lovable face, one felt, even though London had robbed it of some of its open-air freshness. She walked up to the man's side, and seeing the expression on his face as he gazed out over the wet roofs, she said, "Yes, it is, rather, isn't it? After Croft." "Oh, don't talk of Croft, child, or you'll bring my spring madness upon me before it's time. I have had hints of it this morning, as it is. It seems almost incredible that we have only been 2 years and 4 months away from Croft, and the old open life. I was looking at the picture of the mistress of the kennels just now. Do you remember that morning? Tara's first litter hadn't long been weaned. My goodness, the air was sweet in that meadow. That was the morning poor old crippled Eileen ran the rabbit down. You remember?" "Yes, and it was old Tara's third day out after that awful illness. Well, well, it's a blessed thing to know that the old dear is happy and has such a lovely home down in Devonshire, isn't it?" "Yes, oh yes, I know it might have been worse, and I'm a brute to be discontented, but 2.5 years, why, it seems more like 20 since we lived in a place where you could lean out of the window and drink the air. where I could go outside in my pajamas before tubbing in the morning and see the dogs and set the rabbits flying in the orchard. 2 years and 4 months! Do you know, if we give spring madness half a chance this year, it strikes me it will lead us out of this huddled, pent-in town, out to the open again. I almost think we could manage it now. I hardly seem to have lifted my nose from that table since last summer, but it's true the bank book shows small results as yet. And 4 years was to be the minimum, wasn't it? We thought of 5 at first. Yes, oh yes, I know. My idea was that we would not go back till it seemed sure we should be able really to stay. No more returns to town with our tails between our legs. But all the same, when I look out of that window, if we really lived cottage style, you know. But should we? Cottages don't have kennels, you know. Not wolfhound kennels, anyhow. I know. Oh, of course, it would be quite unjustifiable, quite mad. But I thought I felt signs of spring madness when I looked out of that window this morning. Oh, well, now do you know what I came in for? I came to tell you that this is the last day of the dog show at the Agricultural Hall. You remember that I have to go over to Mrs. Kenneth's this afternoon, and I think it would be a good plan for you to take an afternoon off and go to the show. If you don't, it will be the 3rd year you have missed it. I really think you ought to go. It will do you good. I should hardly have thought a dog show was a good thing for spring madness and the change fever. Rather dangerous, I should have thought, said the man, with a queer little twisted smile. Oh, yes, I think it is all right. Quite bracing, a sort of trial of strength, and quite safe, because we know that madness in that direction is simply and altogether impossible. You have been working too hard, and besides, it will do you good to meet the people. You will see a lot of the youngsters we reared. There are 3 champions among them now. Do go. A little more than an hour later, he was on his way to the dog show, at which in other days he had been one of the principal exhibitors. A bout of ill health, combined with consequent diminution of earnings and a characteristic habit of doing things on a more generous scale than his income justified, had led to a break-up of his country home, with its big kennels and stabling, and a descent upon London in pursuit of economical living and increased earnings. Parting with the kennels and their inhabitants had been the severest wrench of all, and it is probable that even in the mean little town flat, room would have been found for Tara, the well-loved mother of Irish Wolfhound heroes, but for the special circumstance that an excellent home had been offered for her in Devonshire. The Devonshire lady to whom Tara had, after long deliberations, been sold by the master, had been extremely keen upon purchasing her, and in addition to offering a splendid home, had faithfully promised that in no circumstances whatever would she think of parting with Tara, unless to the master himself. Here, then, was an opportunity which the man had felt that he could not afford to miss. He had been very much concerned about other matters and other troubles at the time, but when the actual morning of Tara's departure had arrived, he had begun to feel very bad about it. The household gathered round to bid good-bye to the beautiful hound, and her master himself took her to the station. When Tara was in the guard's van, she looked out through a barred window at her friend on the station platform, and he said afterwards that the situation exhausted every ounce of self-control he possessed. He had an overpowering impulse, even when the train was moving, to jump aboard and release old Tara. I would sooner face the bankruptcy court than have her mournful old eyes turned upon me again with just that wonderingly reproachful look, he said. But glowing reports were received of Tara's happiness in her new home, with its extensive grounds and generous management, and though Tara was never forgotten, one does not forget such a mother of heroes when one has bred her and nursed her through mortal illness, her master had ceased to grieve about her, or to feel self-reproachful about having parted with her. Arrived in the great show building, he wandered up and down between the benches, pausing now and again to speak to an old acquaintance, human or canine, as the case might be. But this was the last day of the show, and the majority of the exhibitors were away. The place had a half-dismantled air about it. The show was virtually over. Presently the master found himself in a kind of outbuilding, where an auction sale of dogs was being held. There he sat down on a chair at the edge of the ring, in which the dogs for sale were being led to and fro by attendants for inspection. After a while, a young Irish wolfhound was led into the ring for sale, and immediately monopolized the master's attention, for it was a dog of his own breeding, sold by him from the country home croft soon after weaning time. He handled the dog with a deal of interest, and was expatiating upon its merits to a small group of possible buyers, when he felt another dog nuzzling his arm and wrist from behind, where it was evidently held by a chain, or in some other way prevented from coming farther forward, for its muzzle was pressing hard under his cuff. But the master was too much interested in examining the young hound then being offered for sale to pay any attention to any other animal. In due course, however, the young wolfhound was sold and led away, and the auctioneer was heard to say, "And now, ladies and gentlemen, we come to lot number 127, lot 127, yes, ladies and gentlemen, the dam of the fine young hound just sold, a remarkable good bargain, to my friend Mr. Shar Hislop. This magnificent bitch, whose show record I will read to you directly, is, most of you are probably aware, by the famous champion O'Leary X. Come, come, man, let's have that bitch in the ring, please. No one can see her there." The auctioneer spoke sharply to an attendant who stood close to the master's seat, tugging at a chain. The master, who had been busy in conversation up till that moment, turned now to respond to the pressingly affectionate advances of the unseen animal, whose cold muzzle he had felt at his wrist for some minutes past. "Just push her out for me, sir, if you please," said the rebuked attendant sulkily. "I can't get her to budge from your chair. The brute's as strong as a mule." "Let me have the chain a minute," said the master as he rose from his chair. "I expect you frightened the—" "Why, great Caesar! Why, Tara! Tara! Dear old lady! Who the devil put this hound in here?" "Mrs. Forsyth, the owner, put her in. She's for sale without reserve," said a groom, who forced his way forward through the crowd at this moment. The master wasted some moments, but not many, in wondering, disgusted expostulation, while fondling the head of poor Tara, who had stood erect with her forepaws on his shoulders the instant he recognized her, her noble face all alight with gladness and love. Through 10 acutely unhappy minutes she had nuzzled her friend's hand and gained never a hint of recognition or response. Then the master walked up to the auctioneer's rostrum, followed by Tara, who with no apparent effort dragged the sulky, puzzled attendant after him, paying not the slightest heed to his angry jerks at her collar. "I'm sorry," said the auctioneer after a few moments' conversation, "but I cannot possibly postpone the sale, can I? I had my instructions direct from the owner, and she should know. I am told the dog is positively to be sold, and no, there is no reserve at all. Yes, certainly, I will take your check as deposit, if you will get it endorsed by the show secretary, but—" "Oh, very well, sir. No need to blame me about it. I'll give you 5 minutes. Bring in lot 128, Johnson." 5 minutes was not much of a respite, but the master meant to make the most of it. See old Tara put up and sold to a dealer in the ring? He felt he could not. The bare idea of her being held there in the auction room by a show attendant, Tara, the queen of wolfhound mothers, the daughter of innumerable generations of wolfhound queens, the noblest living dam of her noble race, was maddening to the man who had bred and reared her, seen her through her puppy ills, and bred from her the most famous hounds of the day. The groom said Mrs. Forsyth was in the tea room, and there the master sought her, with anger and anxiety in his eye, sought her unavailingly and in a frenzy of haste. To and fro he hurried through the huge, noisy show building. At one moment of his fruitless search, he obtained a card from the show secretary stating that his check might be accepted. But even as he thanked the worried official for his confidence in an old exhibitor, he realized with bitterness that he could not by any stretch of fancy pretend that he was able to afford anything like the sort of price that Tara would bring. Not a sign did he see of Mrs. Forsyth, and at last a kennelman, whom he remembered tipping years before for some slight service, informed him that he had seen Mrs. Forsyth leaving the building some time before. Almost despairing now, and conscious that the limit of time given him was past, he hurried back to the auction room, caught a glimpse of his beautiful Tara standing sorrowful and stately in the ring, head and tail both carried low, and heard a tall, clean-shaven man in a kennel coat bid 48 guineas for her. 48? Echoed the auctioneer. This magnificent Irish wolfhound bitch, the dam of many winners and two champions, is positively going for 40. Why, gentlemen, she'd be worth that to the National History Museum. 49, cried the master, with a tightening of his lips. And then he saw the mean, ferrety face of a well-known low-class dealer thrust forward from among the crowd. This dealer was notorious for keeping a large number of big Danes and Newfoundlands in the miserable backyard of a cobbler's shop in the East End of London. He had been ordered out of show rings before that day for malpractices. He had never owned a wolfhound, but he was a shrewd business judge of the values of dogs. He nodded to the auctioneer, and that gentleman nodded responsively before taking up his tale afresh. 50 guineas only is offered for the celebrated Irish wolfhound Tara by the famous champion O'Leary. 50 guineas only is offered, and the time is running merrily on, gentlemen, all the time. 50 guineas only is offered, and 51 guineas, thank you, sir. 51 guineas is my last bid for... The auctioneer babbled serenely on, and the master followed his words, rather pale in the face now, for 51 guineas was a great deal more than he could afford to pay at this time for such a purpose. The ferret-faced dealer raised the price to 53 guineas, and the master bit his lip and made it 54. "May I say 55 for you, sir?" said the auctioneer to the clean-shaven man in the kennel coat. "If you'll just wait a moment, sir, I must ask my..." The clean-shaven man was edging his way toward the back of the crowd, where several ladies and gentlemen were seated at a table just out of sight of the ring. "Time and tide and auctioneers wait for no man, sir," continued the auctioneer. "The hammer is very near to falling, gentlemen. The magnificent St. Bernard dog, the magnificent Irish wolfhound Tara is going for 54 guineas only. For 54 guin and one. Thank you, sir," this to the ferret-faced dealer. "At 55 guineas only, this noble animal is going for Why, gentlemen, what has come over us this afternoon? Her record alone is worth more than that. You must know that if this animal were sold by private treaty, double the sum would not purchase her. What am I to say for the gentleman who appeared to be recognized by this fine animal? Surely, sir, civility demands a little recognition of such touching devotion." "We're not dealing in personalities, sir," snapped the master. 60 guineas. And then he turned on his heel, this desperate bid being far more than he could afford. The auctioneer smiled amiably. "As you say, sir, this is strict business, and all I am offered for this magnificent hound, gentlemen, is 60 guineas. But my instructions are to sell, gentlemen, and sell I must, whatever the figure." He raised his hammer. "At 60 guineas, gent—" "And one. At 61 guineas, gentlemen. Lot number 127 is going. A rare bargain for somebody. Going. Will nobody try another guinea on this magnificent—thank you, sir. That's a little better, gentlemen. 70 guineas, I think you said, sir?" This to the man in the kennel coat, who had returned from his visit to the back of the crowd. The ferret-faced dealer who had bid 61 guineas now turned his back on the ring, and as he heard the cry of 70 guineas, the master moved slowly forward among the crowd toward the door of the building. He dared not offer more, and he could not wait to see Tara led out of the ring by some stranger. He paused a moment, without looking up, and heard the auctioneer's "Going, going, gone." Then he walked to the entrance of the main hall to escape from the scene of so grievous a disappointment. Outside, in the main building, while moodily filling a pipe, the master decided that, whatever happened, he must find out who had purchased Tara in order that he might put in a word for his dear old friend, and thereby, it might be, ensure more consideration for her in her new home. There were one or two little whims and peculiarities of hers which he must explain. He thought of pretty Mrs. Forsyth and her broken pledge regarding Tara. He looked along the dusty, littered hall, and in the distance saw an elderly lady leading an Irish wolfhound. A moment later, and he recognized the hound as Tara, and the lady as a good friend of his own, a kindly, wealthy Yorkshire woman, who had bought 2 whelps of him before he left the country, and with whom he had corresponded since. He had visited this lady, too, to help her in the matter of some doggy trouble of hers. Now she was walking directly toward him, leading Tara, and smiling and nodding to him. Just then the lady leaned forward and unsnapped Tara's chain. In an instant the great hound bounded forward to greet her well-loved friend, the master, furiously nuzzling his hands and finally standing erect to reach his face, a paw on either shoulder, her soft eyes glistening, brimming over with canine love and delight. The man's eyes were not altogether dry either, as he muttered and growled affectionate nonsense in Tara's silky ears. His heart swelled as he felt the tremulous excitement in the great hound's limbs. You see, dear old Tara cannot be deceived. She knows her real friends, said the lady from Yorkshire, as she shook hands with the master. Please take her chain and never give anyone else the right to handle it. You will allow me this pleasure, I am sure, if only because of the love I bear Tara's son. One of the whelps this lady had bought from him was a son of Tara. I know Mrs. Forsyth quite well, a whimsical, fanciful little person who takes up a new fad every month and is apt to change her pets as often as her gloves. I could not possibly let a stranger buy the beautiful mother of my dullard, and it gives me so much real pleasure to be the means of bringing her to your hands again. This good woman bowed her silvery head when the master took her hand in his, because she had caught a glimpse of what glistened in his eyes as he tried to give words to the gratitude that filled a heart already swelled by another emotion inspired by Tara. They walked all the way home, the master and Tara, and twice they made considerable detours, despite the distance still before them, for the sake of spending a few minutes in open spaces where there was grass, smutty and soiled, it is true, but grass, and comparative solitude. In these places they exchanged remarks, and Tara placed a little London mud on each of the master's shoulders, and he made curious noises in his throat, such as Tara had been wont to associate with early morning scampers in an upland orchard after rabbits. At last they came to the mansions, and made great show of creeping along close to the railing, and dodging quickly in at the entrance to avoid being overlooked from the windows above. As a matter of fact, tenants of the flats in these buildings were not supposed to keep dogs at all, while the idea of an Irish wolfhound, 32 inches high the shoulder, but it was little the master cared that night. The meeting between Tara and the mistress of the kennels was a spectacle which afforded him real joy. The flat seemed ridiculously tiny when once Tara was inside it, but like all her race, this mother of heroes was a marvel of deftness, and could walk in and out of the mistress's little drawing-room without so much as brushing a chair-leg. There was great rejoicing in the little flat that night, and a great deal of wonderful planning, too, I make no doubt. And this was how Tara, the mother of heroes, returned to the friends who had watched over her birth and early training, and later motherhood, with every sort of loving care. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Finn the Wolfhound by Alec John Dawson. Chapter 2. In the Beginning. It was little that Tara the Wolfhound cared about the lack of space, so that she could stretch her great length along a hearthrug, with her long bearded muzzle resting on her friend's slippers, and gaze at him while he sat at his work, through the forest of overhanging eyebrows which screened her soft brown eyes. And in any case, the next 4 months of her life, after the happy meeting at the show which restored her to her old friend, were too full of changing happenings and variety of scene and occupation to leave time for much consideration about the size of quarters and matters of that like. For one thing, it was within a few days of the show that Tara was taken on a 2 days' trip to a farm in Oxfordshire, where she renewed her old acquaintance with one of the greatest aristocrats of her race, Champion Dermot Ashore, the father of those great young hounds she had given to the world during her life with the master. The children, whose subsequently earned champion honours reflected glory upon herself as the most famous living mother of her breed, though not the most famous show-dog. The qualities which win the greatest honour in the show-ring are not always the qualities which make for famous motherhood. As a show-hound merely, Tara might have been beaten by dams of her race who had not half her splendid width of flank and chest and general massiveness, though they might have a shade more than her height and raciness. After that, something considerable seemed to happen pretty well every day. The master spoke laughingly of the spring madness that was as quicksilver to his heels, and of great profit to furniture removers. He laughed a good deal in those early spring days, and took Tara and the mistress of the kennels with him on quite a number of journeys from Victoria Railway Station. Tara heard much talk of Sussex Downs, and when she came to scamper over them, found herself in thorough agreement with every sort of joyous encomium she heard passed upon them. Then there came a day of extraordinary confusion at the little flat, when men with aprons stamped about and turned furniture upside down and made foolish remarks about Tara as she sat beside the writing-table, gravely watching them. That night Tara slept in a loose box in the stable of a country inn, and in the early morning went out for a glorious run on the downs with the master, who seemed to have grown younger since they left London. Within a very few days from this time, Tara and her friends had settled down comfortably in a new home. An oddly shaped little house it was, full of unexpected angles and doors, and having a garden and orchard which straggled up the lower slope of one of the downs. It had a stable, too, of a modest sort, and rather poky, but the coach-house was admirable, light, airy, facing south-east, and having a new concrete floor, which the master helped to lay with his own hands. The back half of this coach-house consisted of a slightly raised wooden dais, a very pleasant place for a wolfhound to lie when spring sunshine was flooding the coach-house. But Tara did not spend much of her time there, for between the stabling and the house there was a big wooden structure with a tiled roof, large as a good-sized barn, but with an entrance like an ordinary house-door, and comfortably matchboarded inside, like a wooden house. A pleasant old villager who was doing some work in the garden referred to this place as the old parish room, but the master made it his own den, lined one of its sides with books and pictures of dogs and men and fields and kennels. He had his big writing table established there, with a sufficiency of chairs, a few rugs upon the 40 feet length of floor, and an old couch upon one side, manufactured by himself with the aid of an ancient spring mattress, a few blocks of wood, a big possum-skin rug, which some friend had sent him from Australia, and a variety of cushions. The actual house, for all its rambling shape, was small, and possibly this was why the master chose to utilize this outside space as his den, and to fix a big stove in it for heating. Here, too, at one end, and just beyond the big writing table, was a raised wooden dais or bed, like that in the coach-house, a good 6 feet square, with sides to it, perhaps 6 inches high. Tara watched the making of this dais, and saw the master cover its floor with a kind of sawdust that had a strong, pleasant smell, and then nail down a tightly stretched piece of old carpet over that, making altogether, as she thought, a very excellent bed. And as such, Tara used it by night, but in the daytime she usually preferred to stretch herself beside the writing-table or on the rug by the door, where the sunshine formed a pool of light and warmth on a fine morning. Here it was that Tara took her meals, a dish of milk in the morning with a little bread or biscuit, and the real meal of the day, the dinner, which the mistress of the kennels always prepared with her own hands, so that it was full of delightful surprises and variety, though everything in it had the moisture and flavor of meat in the evening. At about this time it was that Tara noticed a kind of white sediment, quite inoffensive and not at all bad to eat, in her morning milk dish, and this she welcomed because in some dim way it was connected in her mind with happy old days that came before her parting with the master, when she had lived with him in a place not unlike this clean, fragrant downland, which stretched now far as one could see on either hand, outside the garden and the orchard, all about this new home which Tara found so good. At certain times and in certain circumstances, some breeders of big hounds believe in mixing precipitated phosphate of lime with ordinary food for the sake of its bone-forming properties. To describe one half the many delightful incidents and occupations which made the days pass quickly for Tara now would require a volume, but as time went, the great hound tended to become less active. There were any number of rabbits on the downs beyond the orchard, and at first, in her before-breakfast ramble with the master, Tara used greatly to enjoy running down one or two of these. But after a little time the master seemed to make a point of discouraging this, even to the extent of resting a hand lightly upon Tara's collar as she walked beside him, and gradually she herself lost inclination for the sport, except where greatly tempted, as by a rabbit's jumping suddenly for its burrow close beside her. In the afternoon, when Tara generally went out with the mistress of the kennels for a good long round, she wore a lead on her collar now, so that even sudden inspirations to galloping were checked in the bud, and a sedate gait was maintained always. Without troubling her head to think much about it, Tara had a generally contented feeling that these precautions were wise and good. The same prudent feeling influenced her in the matter of meals now. Though she frequently felt that she would much rather be without her morning milk, she always lapped it carefully up and conscientiously swabbed the dish bright and dry with her great red tongue. She could not have explained, even to herself, just why she did these things, but subconscious understandings and foreknowledge play a large part in a wolfhound's life, and so does subconscious memory and the inherited thing we call instinct. Without considering a prehistoric ancestry, there were 1,500 years of lineal Irish wolfhound ancestry behind Tara. Her own family dated back so far. For instance, In the year 391, 7 centuries before the conqueror landed in England, there was a Roman consul whose name was Quintus Aurelius Symmachus. In a letter that he wrote to his brother Flavianus, he said, "In order to win the favor of the Roman people for our quaestor, you have been a generous and diligent provider of novel contributions to our solemn shows and games, as is proved by your gift of 7 Irish hounds. All Rome viewed them with wonder, and fancied they must have been brought hither in iron cages. For such a gift I tender you the greatest possible thanks." That these Irish wolfhounds of 1500 years ago were big and fierce and brave and strong, you may know from the conviction of the Roman people that they must have been brought in iron cages. Also, friend Symmachus writes in other letters of the boars and lions and the armed Saxons provided to do battle with the Irish wolfhounds. Also, he shows the quaintest sort of annoyance over the fact that some 29 of these perverse Saxons who were obtained to fight the Irish wolfhounds cut their throats on the night before the games, their own throats, I mean, and so spoiled sport for the holiday-loving Romans. In the 1st century of our era, Mesroidia, the king of the Leinstermen, had an Irish wolfhound which was so mighty in battle that it was said to defend the whole province and to fill all Ireland with its fame. For this hound, 6,000 cows, besides other property, were offered by the king of Connaught, and about the same price was offered by the king of Ulster. Irish wolfhounds fought regularly in battle through the early centuries of our era, and fearsome warriors they were. Right down to the period of a couple of centuries ago, a leash of Irish wolfhounds was considered a fitting and acceptable present for one monarch or lord to offer to another king or great noble, while from the earliest times down to the day of Buffon, and in our own time, Stonehenge, the naturalists have written of the Irish wolfhound as the greatest, that is, finest and tallest of all dogs. But it was not alone in such matters as refraining from violent exercise and the taking of food, whether inclined for it or not, that a sort of prescience guided beautiful Tara at this time in her new home beside the Sussex Downs. There came a morning when, as she strolled about the strip of shrubbery and orchard which lay between the stabling and the house, it occurred to her that it would be a good thing to dig a hole somewhere in the ground, the sort of hole or cave into which a great hound like herself could creep for shelter if need be, a cave in which she could live for a while. Tara did not know that the master was watching her at this time, but he was, and there was a sympathetic and understanding sort of smile on his face when Tara forced her way in between 2 large shrubs and began excavating. The earth was soft and moist there, and Tara's powerful forefeet scooped it out in regular shovelfuls for her hind feet to scatter in an earthly rain behind her. She made a cavern as big as herself, and then divided the rest of the day between the beautiful big dais in the coach-house, all dry and sweet and clean, and her fragrant carpeted great bed in the old parish-room. Lying there at her ease, with one eye on the master's shoulder, where it showed round the side of his high-topped writing-table, Tara wondered vaguely why she had troubled to dig that hole in the wet earth. But the master knew all about it, though he could not claim to have 1500 years of wolfhound ancestry behind him, and he seemed quite satisfied. On the following day, Tara gravely inspected the hole she had dug and decided that it was not altogether good. So she went and dug another in a rather more secluded spot, and then came back and dozed comfortably at the master's feet while he wrote. Later on in the day she strolled round the whole premises and inspected carefully the various places in which, during the past week or so, she had buried large bones. The next day found Tara extremely restless and rather unhappy. She had an uncomfortable feeling that she had forgotten some important matter which required attention. In her effort to recall what the thing could be that she had neglected, she dug two or three more holes, and finally, a thing she had never thought of doing before, took one of the master's slippers, always a singularly dear and comforting piece of property to Tara, and buried it about 2 feet deep in a little ditch. She felt vaguely ashamed about this, though she had no idea that the master had watched her taking the slipper away, but she could not bring herself to return the slipper because of the hazy need she felt for laying up treasure and taking every sort of precaution against a rainy day. During the afternoon, Tara's general uneasiness increased. She felt thoroughly uncomfortable and worried, convinced that she had forgotten some really important matter and disinclined either to go out or to stay in. 50 times the master opened and closed doors to suit her changing whims, until poor Tara felt quite ashamed of herself, though still quite unable to settle down. As a sort of savory after dinner, the master gave her some silky, warm olive oil, an odd thing to take, Tara thought, but upon the whole pleasing and comforting. Then suddenly, and as she woke from a doze of about 10 seconds' duration, Tara decided that it would be a good thing to tear a hole in the middle of the tight-stretched old carpet on her big bed. She got to work at once, pleased to think that she had remembered this little matter in good time, and was distinctly disappointed when the master came and sat beside her on the edge of the bed and playfully held her paws, after gently lowering her into a lying position. Still, it was good to have him sit there and chat, as he did for some little time, rubbing the backs of her ears and generally being sociable. He was the only human creature, with the exception of the mistress of the kennels, who had ever really chatted with Tara. While Tara was gradually forgetting her desire to tear the bed covering, a cart stopped outside the house, and a whiff, the hint of an odor, drifted in through the open door of the den and caused the great hound's nose to wrinkle ominously. Next moment she gave a savage bark, deep, threatening, and sonorous, and sprang to her feet. She was not quite sure what ailed her, but she was conscious of an access of great anger, of passionate hostility. After soothing her, the master carefully locked the door of the den, and then went round through the gateway leading to the front of the house, and took delivery of a large hamper from the station carrier. Then the mistress of the kennels came and sat in the master's den for perhaps half an hour, while he was busy down at the coach-house with the hamper and a lantern and a dish of dog's dinner of milky, sloppy sort. That was a strange, eventful night in the den. All the country round was silent as the grave, and the air of the June night was soft and sweet as the petals of wild roses. The mistress of the kennels was persuaded into going early to bed, but the master sat behind his big table, writing beneath a carefully shaded lamp, and rising quietly every now and again to peer over the top of the high table in the direction of the big bed in the shadow where Tara lay. Many things happened in the meantime, but it was just after the clock in the tower of the village church had struck the hour of one that the master was thrilled by a cry from his beloved Tara, the fifth he had heard during the past 3.5 hours. He leaned forward on his elbows, waiting and listening. Tara had never heard of duty or self-control. She was a pure child of nature. But the moment of that cry of hers was the only moment she allowed for self-consideration, or the play of her own inclinations. In the next moment she was busying herself with the most exquisite delicacy and precision over the care of her latest offspring, the last latecomer in her new family of five. In that next instant, too, a weak, bleating little cry, a voice that was not at all like Tara's, smote pleasantly upon the ears of the master, where he waited, peering watchfully from beside the deep-shaded lamp on his table. It was then, just after the master heard that little bleating cry which told of new life in the world, that Tara, with infinite care and precaution, lowered her great bulk upon the bed in a coil, she had been standing, the center of which was occupied by four glossy Irish wolfhound puppies, who had arrived respectively at 10, 11, 12, and 12:30 that night. The four, then blindly grovelling over the carpeted bed, were now perfectly sheltered in the still heaving hollow of their mother's flank. These comparatively world-worn pups had not arranged themselves conveniently in a cluster to receive their loving mother's caress. On the contrary, they were all groping in different directions at the moment in which Tara's pain-racked body was lowered to rest and to shelter them. But while yet that great body hung over them in the act of descending, it had twisted and curved into the required lines, and a soft muzzle had thrust this puppy that way, and the other another way, the mother's soft, filmy eyes missing nothing before her or behind. One inch of miscalculation, and the life had been crushed out of one of those tiny creatures. But pain brought no miscalculation for Tara. One quick movement of her head satisfied the mother that her four firstborn were safe and well disposed. Immediately then, with never a thought of rest, her nose thrust the newcomer into position between her forepaws, and she proceeded to administer the life-giving and stimulating tongue wash. Over and over the little shapeless gray form was turned, cheeping and bleating, until every crevice of its soft anatomy had come under the vivifying sweep of 6 inches of scarlet tongue, warm and tenderly rough. Then the mother's sensitive nose thrust and coaxed the little creature to its nesting place under her flank, where three sisters and a brother already nosed complainingly among milk-swollen dugs, quite indifferent to the coming of an addition to their number, and desiring they knew not what, desiring it lustily. Then, and not till then, did the beautiful mother of these new-born descendants of an ancient race permit herself to draw a long breath of relief and lower her massive head upon her forepaws. A moment later, and a desire which overcame weariness impelled Tara to part her hot jaws and glance in the direction of the shaded lamp. No least movement of hers escaped the master, and in the moment of her glance he came forward with a dish of fresh cold water in his hand. The mother lapped slowly, weakly, gratefully, thanking whatever god she knew and the friend whose hand and eye were so ready for the balm of water. The man moved very gently and deftly before her, and no anxiety came into her brown eyes when he leaned forward to examine the now resting litter at her flank. But it had gone hardly, one fancied, with the stranger or even with the casual acquaintance who should have approached too inquisitively the little family. "There, there, pet. All right, my Tara girl," murmured the man, as he stepped back softly to his table, to return a moment later with a dish of warm milk and water, which the slightly rested mother drank with forethoughtful eagerness, though the effort necessary for lapping in that constrained position, and without disturbing the little ones beside her, was far from pleasant, and far enough from personal inclination. 10 minutes later the dam very gently changed her position, all idea of rest having left her now, and proceeded systematically to lick first her own swollen dugs and then the little featureless faces of her offspring with many small encouraging muzzle thrusts and undulations of her sinuous frame. While the master, ready to give assistance if that were required, but too knowledgeable in these matters to wish to hasten nature or botch the delicate handiwork of the mother, stood in the shadow of his big table, watching and waiting. Within another few minutes the five pups were immersed in the most important affair of life, from their point of view, and with wriggling tails and tiny heaving flanks, with impatient outthrust pink forefeet, wet faces, and gaping little jaws, were nursing in a row like clockwork. The mother turned a proud, filmy eye in the direction of her friend, the master, and allowed her massive head to fall on its side, her whole great form outstretched to reap the benefit of a few more minutes of needed repose. "Good girl!" whispered the master, and, stepping backward, he turned yet lower than it was the wick of his shaded lamp. "Good! Excellent! Five's a very good number. I should have been sorry to see a big litter for dear old Tara, and anyhow that last one, the grey, is about equal to any two I ever saw, an immense whelp, dog for sure, and a giant at that." The master lay down to sleep presently on the couch with the possum skin rug, and before many hours of the June daylight had passed, he had verified his impressions of that last born son of Tara's as a grey brindle and the biggest whelp of its age that he had ever seen. For purposes of registration in the books of the Kennel Club, the Debrett of the dog world, the latecomer was forthwith christened by the mistress of the kennels under the name of Finn, in honour of the memory of the 4th century warrior Finn, son of Cumal, lord of 300 Irish wolfhounds, whose prowess in battle and in the chase were sung by Oisin in 2,272 separate verses. Finn was chief of King Cormac's household and master of his hounds, for the most honoured counsellor that the ancient kings of Ireland had were masters of the hounds always. And this was the way of the Irish wolfhound Finn's entry into the world at the end of the first hour of a June day in the master's den beside the Sussex Down. You may see the embalmed body of his great mother's sire, Champion O'Leary, if you care to look for it in the Natural History Museum in Kensington. Woefully shorn of his imposing beard and shaggy eyebrows, it is true, but yet only less magnificent in death than he was always in life. Her mother was the dam of the hound who marches today at the head of his master's Irish guards. Between them, the sire and dam of Finn would have scaled 300 pounds, while either could easily have stretched to a height above the shoulders of a 6-foot man. Finn rested easily in the palm of the master's right hand when christened by the mistress of the kennels, for he was little bigger than a week-old kitten. But he was none the less Finn, the lineal descendant of King Cormac's battle-hounds of 1,500 years ago, and it was said he had the makings of the biggest wolf-hound ever bred. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of Finn the Wolfhound by Alec John Dawson. Chapter 3. The Foster Mother. Finn's first adventure came to him when he was no more than about 37 hours old, and of course still blind as any bat. That being so, it may be taken that the grey whelp was not particularly interested. Still, the event was important, and probably affected the whole of Finn's afterlife. This was the way of it. Early in the second morning of his life in this beautiful world, Finn was lying snugly asleep between his mother's hind legs on the great bed at the stove-end of the outside den. When a litter of puppies are lying with their mother, there is always one place which is snugger, and in various ways rather better than any other place. You would have said that the little, more or less shapeless, blind lump of gristle and skin that was Finn at this stage had no more intelligence or reasoning power than a potato, but it is to be noted that from the very beginning this best place had been exclusively occupied by him, and if while he slept one of his wakeful brothers or sisters crawled over him and momentarily usurped his proud position, then in the very moment of his awakening that other puppy would be rolled backward, full of gurgling and futile protestation, and Finn would resume the picked place. Whatever was best in the way of warmth and food and comfort, that Finn obtained, even in this absurdly rudimentary stage, by token of superior weight, energy, and vitality. Also, though the last to be born, Finn was the first to approach the achievement of standing, for an instant, upon his own little pink-padded feet, and the first, by days, to dream of the impertinence of blindly pawing his mother's wet satin nose while that devoted parent washed her family. But Finn and the rest were sound asleep, and Tara was dozing, with one brown eye uncovered, when the master came into the den on that second morning, and spoke invitingly to his beloved mother of heroes. The great bitch rose slowly and with gentle care, and Finn, with the other sucklings, rolled helplessly on his back, sleepily cheeping a puny remonstrance, though he had no idea what he wanted. Then, in his ridiculously masterful way, Finn, grovelling, burrowed under the other puppies that he might have the benefit of all their warmth, and was asleep again. Tara eyed the blind things for a moment with maternal solicitude, and then, seeing that all was well with them, followed the master out into the bright, fresh sunshine of the stable-yard. She did not think about it, but she was perfectly well aware that it was desirable for her to take fresh air and move about a little to stretch her great limbs. "Come and see the mistress, old lady. Come along and stretch yourself," said her friend. And so Tara strolled round the yard twice, and then across to the back kitchen door, where, inside the house, she had some warm bread and milk with the mistress of the kennels. Tara lapped steadily and conscientiously, but without much appetite. Suddenly, when the basin was about three-quarters empty, she realized with a start that the master had left her. One quick look she gave to right and left, and then, the mother anxiety shining in her brown eyes, she reached the outer door in a bound. "Look out for Tara!" cried the mistress through the open window, and, "All right, I'm clear now. Let her in, will you?" answered the master from beyond the gate leading to the coach-house. So the mistress opened the house door, and in three cat-like bounds Tara reached the door of the den and stood erect, her forepaws against the door, more than 6 feet above the ground. "There, there, pet, your children are all right, you see," said the mistress as she let Tara into the den. In a moment, lighter of foot than a terrier, for all that she weighed as much as an average man, Tara was in the midst of the big bed, where she saw her puppies bunched snugly and asleep. She looked up gratefully at the mistress as the roused pups, she had touched them with her nose, came mewing about her feet and coiled down at once to nurse them, apparently unconscious of the fact that there were only 4 mouths to feed instead of 5. One cannot say for certain whether or not she missed Finn then. She licked the 4 assiduously while they nursed, and in any case 4 gaping little mouths and 4 wriggling helpless little bodies represent a considerable claim upon a wolfhound mother's attention and strength. Also, it may be that if she did not notice that the big gray whelp was missing, she was too wise and devoted a mother and nurse to allow herself to injure the remaining 4 by fretting and worrying over matters beyond her immediate control. One must remember, too, that Tara lived in an atmosphere of the most implicit confidence, in which she never even heard an unkind word. On the other hand, if there had been no puppies at all on that bed when Tara returned from her brief excursion to the back kitchen, then it is likely that the big den would have not been strong enough to have held her for long within its wooden walls. The room had windows, and matchboarding and weatherboard are not like iron. Having seen Tara comfortably settled down with her family of 4, the mistress hurried back to the house in time to see the master unwrapping little Finn from a soft old blanket and placing him carefully in the midst of 3 puppies of perhaps half his size in a hamper near the kitchen stove. Finn bleated rather languidly for 2 minutes in his new environment, and then, being very full of milk and very warm, forgot what the trouble was and fell asleep. The master closed the lid of the hamper then and said, "I'll let them have a good 2 hours together there. Finn ought to assimilate the smell of the others pretty well by then. What do you think of the foster?" "Oh, I like her," said the mistress of the kennels. "She seems a nice, affectionate little beast, and I think she has quite recovered from the effects of that awful journey."
"Yes. 12 or 14 hours' travelling with 3 newborn pups must be rather awful, poor little beast. Did she take her breakfast?"
"Yes, a first-rate meal. And I think she will be a good mother. She seems to have any amount of milk, more than is comfortable for her, poor little thing."
"Yes, that's exactly what I want. I want her to be uncomfortably heavy for the time, and then she will be the less likely to resent my great big Finn's introduction. It's only discomfort, you know, not pain, and we shall put it right in a couple of hours."
"Then you have decided to put Finn to the foster mother?"
"Yes. You see, poor old Tara, well, she..."
"Yes, I know. She's poor old Tara, spoiled darling."
The master chuckled. "Well, perhaps it is partly that, and anyway, she deserves it. The old girl has done a good share of prize-winning and nursing and the rest of it. I think of her as a lady who has earned repose, particularly after..."
"Yes, I know. The illness, you mean."
"Well, anyhow, I think 4 pups quite enough for her to nurse, and as a matter of fact, I am none too comfortable about that. You know I have always believed that that awful bout of mammitis permanently affected her. Her heart and, well, and other things, too. 4 days with a temperature of over 105, you know, and mind you, the vet said she must die. It was, so to say, in spite of nature that we pulled her through. I am not at all sure that we may not have to take them all from her. Well, we shall see better by tonight."
"Yes, I see." The mistress of the kennels was thoughtfully balancing on the tip of her forefinger a big wooden spoon used in the mixing of Tara's meals. "But why do you choose Finn for the foster?"
"Well, now, that's rather a nice point, and involves a conviction of mine which I know you'll resent, because you rightfully think Tara the perfection of all that a wolfhound should be. But the conviction is right all the same. A mongrel's milk is far stronger, heartier food than the milk of so highly bred a great lady as dear old Tara. Tara gives the most aristocratic blood in the world, but when you come to food, the nourishment that is to build up bone and muscle and hearty health, that's different. Also, I only mean to give the foster this one pup, though I dare say she is capable of rearing 2 or 3. Therefore, that one pup ought to do exceedingly well with her. Now Finn, as you see him, is the biggest pup I ever knew, and I want to give him every chance of growing into the biggest Irish wolfhound living. That's why he is going to have this sheepdog foster all to his little self, and unless I'm mistaken, you'll find him in a week the fattest little tub of a pup in all England. The fatter the better at this stage, so the food's wholesome and digestible." In about 1 hour from that time, Finn woke among his strange bedfellows and trampled all over them, in a vain and wrathful search for his mother's dugs. Then he bleated vigorously for 3 minutes, and then the warmth of that snug corner of the kitchen sent him off to sleep again. Another hour passed, and when Finn woke this time, one could tell from the furious lunges he made over the little bodies of his foster brothers that he had arrived at a serious determination to let nothing stand any longer between himself and a good square meal. He would take one indignant step forward, as it might have been a rather gouty and very choleric old gentleman prepared to tear down his bell rope if dinner were not served that minute. Then his podgy little forelegs would double up, and the next few inches of progress would be made on blunt little pink nose and round little stomach, his hind legs being flattened out behind him in the exact position of a frog's while swimming. Several times Finn quite thought he had at length found a teat, and in its infantile, impotent way the blind fury he displayed was quite terrible when he discovered that he was merely chewing the muzzle of one of the other pups. On one of these occasions, Finn spluttered and swore so vehemently that the effort completely robbed him of what rudimentary sense of balance he had, and he rolled over on his back, leaving all his four pink feet wriggling in the air in a passion of protest. It was in this undignified position that the master presently found the grey whelp, and he chuckled as he picked up Finn, with two of the other pups, and wrapped them together in a warm blanket. The remaining puppy was handed over to the gardener and seen no more in that place, so it is safe to assume that this little creature's life embraced no sorrows or disillusions. The next thing Finn knew was that his gaping mouth, held open by the master's thumb and forefinger, was being pressed against a soft surface from which warm milk trickled. "At last," one can imagine Finn muttering, as if he had been old enough to know how to talk. Immediately his little hind legs began to work like pistons, and his forepaws to knead and pound at the soft udder from which the milk was drawn. Finn, with his two foster brothers, was at the dugs of the foster mother, a soft-eyed little sheep-dog, then occupying a very comfortable corner of the big bed in the coach-house. The master sat watchfully beside the sheep-dog. She was very glad to be eased of some of her superabundance of milk, and curved her elastic body forward to simplify matters for the pups. Then she began to lick the back and flank of the pup nearest her head, one of her own. The master leaned forward. The foster's sensitive nose passed over the back of the first pup to the wriggling tail of Finn, and her big eyes hardened and looked queerly straight down her muzzle at the fat gray back of the stranger, a back twice as broad as those of her own pups. The black nostrils quivered and expanded, expressing suspicious resentment. No warm tongue curled out over Finn's fat back, but instead a nose made curiously harsh and unsympathetic pushed him clear away from the place he had selected, after spluttering hurried investigation, and out upon the straw of the bed. Immediately then, and almost before Finn's sticky mouth could open in a bleat of protest, the master's hand had returned him to the warm dugs. Again came the harsh, suspicious nose of the foster about Finn's tail, and this time a low growl followed the resentful sniff, and blind, helpless, unformed little jelly that Finn was, instinct made him wriggle fearfully from under that cold nose. The language in which bitches speak to the very young among puppies is simplicity itself. The master, human though he was, had not failed to catch the sense of this observation of the foster's, which was, "Get out of here, you lumping great whelp! You're not mine, and I won't nurse you. Get out, or I'll bite you. It's true you've somehow got the smell of mine, but you can't deceive me. Grrr! Get out!" But though Finn instinctively wriggled his hindquarters from under that cold muzzle, his mouth and forefeet vigorously pursued their business, and before the threatened bite came, the master's hand, a firm one and soothing to dog people, had caressingly pressed the foster's head back upon the straw and held it there. "There now, little woman," he said good-humoredly, "let him have his chance. He's a good pup, and will do you great credit presently." His hand continued to rest on the sheep-dog's neck, or head, till the three pups were comfortably full, and the foster herself was comfortably eased of her bounteous milk supply. Then gently he removed his hand, and the foster proceeded to lick her own two pups with exemplary diligence. Out of consideration for the master, whom she found an obviously well-meaning person, she refrained from taking any active steps against the big gray pup, but she very pointedly ignored him. And when, in due course, Finn came galumphing about her neck with all the doddering insolence of the full-fed pup, she turned her head in the opposite direction with cool superciliousness, and exhaled a long breath through her nose, as though she found the air offensive. But the master petted her and gave her a very little warm bread and milk. Then he took the three puppies away in the warm blanket and handed one of them to someone who waited outside the door of the back kitchen. Finn, with one sleepy foster brother, was placed in the hamper near the kitchen stove. A couple of hours later the foster mother began to worry and to wish that her puppies would come and take another meal. At about the same time, Finn and his diminutive companion in the hamper began to worry and to wish that they could have another meal. 10 minutes after that, they were carried down to the coach house and put to nurse again. While they fed vigorously, the foster, apparently by accident, touched Finn once or twice with her tongue in process of licking her own pup, and she did not growl. "Good," said the master, and he sat down on a little barrel of disinfectant powder to fill a pipe. Then both puppies began to grovel and slide about the foster's legs and body, this being the natural order of things for very young puppies, to feed full, to grovel and wriggle, to sleep, and then to begin again at the beginning. But for the complete comfort and well-being of puppies at this stage, certain maternal attentions, apart from the provision of nourishment, are requisite. For several minutes the foster mother plied her own offspring with every good office, and severely ignored the rotund and would-be playful Finn. Then the sheepdog lay flat on her side and breathed out through her nostrils a statement to the effect that, "That is really quite as far as I can be expected to go. The big gray creature has fed beside mine, and I have suffered it, as a matter of charity. But no more. The great clumsy thing must shift for itself now." But Finn appeared to think otherwise. His mode of progression was rather that of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.